Praise the Lord, everybody, and welcome to our Fountain of Life service. Thank you for joining us. We invite you to engage in the service together with your family by praising God, by hearing the Word of God, and by giving. Now let's go before the Lord in prayer. Dear Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, thank you for allowing us to be together in this service. We ask of your presence wherever people are so that you may bless everyone. Thank you, Father, in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Now, let's worship the Lord together. You could stand up and glorify God. Amen.
Praise the Lord, Fountain of Life Church. How many of you are ready to worship this morning? We're going to praise God because He is the God of our breakthrough. Amen. Wherever you are watching us online, go ahead and clap your hands with us as we sing this song to our God. Amen. You ready all together? You are.
You are the undefeated one. My life and my salvation. When the wicked, my enemies and my foes came upon me to eat up my flesh, they stumbled and fell.
That's right, the enemy stumbles upon our feet because our God is with us. Let's all say omnipotent.
Omnipotent, almighty defender, my victory, my refuge. Don't want to run to you. You are the God of the breakthrough.
If He's the God of your breakthrough today, clap your hands up high and shout breakthrough,
breakthrough. You are the God of the breakthrough. And when I can't see my way through, and I really don't know what to do, I look to you. Breakthrough. Walls fall down when I shout through. Strongholds break when I break through. So I'm gonna praise Him. You are the God. You are the God of the breakthrough.
That's who you are to us, God. You are the God of the breakthrough. Let's sing You Are together. Come on.
You are the undefeated one, my life and my salvation. When the wicked, my enemies, and my foes came upon me to eat up my flesh, they stumbled and fell.
Yes, they did. You are walking in authority. All together, let's say omnipotent.
Omnipotent, almighty defender. Victory, my refuge, the one I run to. You are the God. You are the God of the breakthrough.
Can we get excited and then sing? You are the God of the breakthrough. Shout breakthrough,
breakthrough. You are the God of the breakthrough. And when I can't see my way through, and I really don't know what to do, I look to you. Walls fall down when I shout through. Strongholds break when I pray through. So I'm gonna praise Him. You are the God. You are the God of the breakthrough.
That's who You are to us, Jesus. You are the God of the breakthrough. I don't know how you find yourself this morning or in your homes, but God is with you right there. He is causing a breakthrough in your family. He is causing a breakthrough in your home. He is causing a breakthrough in your heart. You just gotta declare the words that I'm gonna sing to you right now. Hallelujah. Breakthrough in my heart, breakthrough in my mind, breakthrough in my spirit, breakthrough in my soul, breakthrough in my weakness, breakthrough in my struggle. You are the God. You are the God of the breakthrough in my worship, breakthrough when I praise, breakthrough when I lift and glorify Your name, breakthrough when I dance, breakthrough when I shout. You are the God. You are the God of the breakthrough in my heart, breakthrough in my mind, breakthrough in my spirit, breakthrough in my soul, breakthrough in my weakness, breakthrough. You are the God.
You are the God.
You are the God of the breakthrough in my worship, breakthrough when I praise, breakthrough when I lift and glorify Your name. Come on, let's get excited.
Breakthrough when I shout. You are the God. You are the God of the breakthrough in my heart, breakthrough in my mind, breakthrough in my spirit, breakthrough in my soul, breakthrough in my weakness, breakthrough in my struggle.
You are the God.
You are the God of the breakthrough in my worship, breakthrough in my praise, breakthrough in my lift and glorify Your name, breakthrough in my dance, breakthrough.
spirit, breakthrough in my soul, breakthrough in my weakness, breakthrough in my struggle. You are the God of the breakthrough in my worship, breakthrough when I praise, breakthrough when I lift and glorify your name, breakthrough when I dance, breakthrough when I shout. You are the God.
You gotta believe the words that we're singing.
Breakthrough in my heart, breakthrough in my mind, breakthrough in my spirit, breakthrough in my soul, breakthrough in my weakness, breakthrough in my strength.
You are the God of my breakthrough.
Breakthrough in my worship, breakthrough when I praise, breakthrough when I lift and glorify your name, breakthrough when I dance, breakthrough when I shout. You are the God, you are the God of the
breakthrough in my heart,
breakthrough in my mind, breakthrough in my spirit, breakthrough in my soul.
Can we get excited wherever you're at, wherever you're watching this? You're gonna have a breakthrough by the name of Jesus.
Breakthrough in my praise, breakthrough when I lift, glorify your name, breakthrough when I dance, breakthrough when I shout. You are the God, you are the God of the breakthrough, 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 breakthrough.
You are the God. You are Jesus. You are the God of the breakthrough today. Amen. Hallelujah. Wherever you're at, can you just lift up your hands and just worship God right now? Let's just lift up our hands to the Father. And let's just ask that His Spirit may be coming into us today. Hallelujah, Jesus. We need more and more of you, Father.
Break out,
heaven come down. Declare one more.
Praise the Lord, Fountain of Life Church, and also we want to welcome all of our friends to that are connected this Sunday morning. We believe that God is good and God has a blessing for your life. I rejoice that to have this privilege to be able to share the message of God with you today. We know we're in perilous times, so many things happening around the world, but we have a trust in our Lord Jesus Christ. And without taking any more time, you know, I want you to follow me reading the scriptures. We're going to read from the book of 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. And we're going to read from verse 13 through 18. So if you have your Bible with you, I do encourage you to open it and follow me. If you don't have a Bible, it's going to be shown on the screen so you can follow us. And let us go before the Lord before we read the scriptures. As we pray, we ask God's guidance so that he can speak to our hearts and to our lives. Let us bow our heads where you at and let us go before the Lord. Heavenly Father, we come before you, my King. Father, we humble before you. We know that you are the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, Father. We thank you for the blessings that you're giving us this day, Father, to be able to hear your message, to hear your word, Father, that your word is bread of life. I ask at this moment, Father, that you will bless every home, that you will bless every person that is connected, and also people that are going to be connected later on, Father, that this message will penetrate their hearts and their lives, Father, as you guide us to do your will for your honor and your glory. I thank you and I worship you, Father, in your precious name, the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Let us go forward I know God is good. I know God is merciful. And today's message, I titled it, The King is Coming. The King is Coming. We read some encouraging words from the Apostle Paul to the Church of Thessalonica with the hope and the promise of our Lord Jesus Christ that he will return for us and his church. Those words, Apostle Paul mentioned it to the churches many times, that, you know, to encourage the saints, to encourage those that were experiencing, you know, persecution and all kinds of tribulations and trials. And even though those words were written thousands of years ago, they're still for today, because the word of God, it says, you know, that heaven and earth will pass away, but his word will never pass away. So it is this word that is still for today, for you that is watching, for you that is listening today. And as we can compare the times, you know, the apostles, the saints, the believers in that time, they experienced so many tribulations. They experienced persecution. You know, if you know about the Apostle Paul, also he was one of the persons that persecuted the church before he got converted to Christ. So when he speaks about these words, he knows, because he came from a background of, you know, persecuting the church to become someone that was being persecuted, you know, that was being chastised for, you know, preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. He was placed in, you know, in a cell, in a dungeon. You know, he was placed, you know, with chains. If you can think about all kinds of punishments, or, you know, all kinds of things, you know, that, you know, to make people suffer or stop doing something, Apostle Paul experienced those things. So when he spoke about these words to the church, he knew what he was talking about. And now in this time, you know, that we're living, we're also living some hard times. We're seeing so many troubled things that are happening, diseases. You know, we, like the scripture says, you know, there has been wars, there's have been famines, so many things that are happening around the world. And there's times in our lives and people's lives that we get discouraged, we get, you know, sad about it. Sometimes, you know, people lose hope. And as time passes by and prophecies unfold before our very eyes, this event that Paul spoke about, that those words that he shared to the church in Thessalonica, you know, that the King is coming, the return of Jesus Christ is coming soon. I believe that the signs that we're living, I believe that the things that we're seeing around, those are all things, those all are all signs that, you know, there are signs that are preparing us for the soon return of our Lord Jesus Christ. But at the same time, you know, we know that these signs that are happening, like I mentioned, you know, famines, diseases, sicknesses, pandemics, you know, these things have brought pain, suffering, and a lot of those cases in many people has brought fear, and they have lost hope. A lot of people are losing hope. And that's what we have to understand, the church especially, but also everyone that is hearing this message. If you're listening to this message, you have to understand that nobody is exempt for suffering. Nobody is exempt to go through the valley of death. Nobody. We're all prone to go through that valley. Everybody, you know, no matter if you're rich, it doesn't matter if you're poor, it doesn't matter if you have a good position in this life and in your country and your city, it doesn't matter who you are. Nobody is exempt. And that's what the Apostle Paul was always trying to share with the church. You know, not only the Apostle Paul, but our Lord Jesus Christ. He said, in this world, you would have tribulation. In this world, we're not exempt. We all have, at one moment, gone through suffering, through different situations. Even many of our beloved brothers, you know, they have lost loved ones through different circumstances. Not necessarily the things that we're living today, the situation that we're living today, but many of our loved ones have gone through suffering, through, you know, seeing their loved ones, you know, being lost through many things. You know, we know there's so many diseases that are, you know, people are dying from. Even people have, you know, gone out of their work and out of their house and never came back, you know, something happened on the way. So, you know, we see this happening all the time, but God promises that he would be with us. He never promised to take away the situation. And as a matter of fact, he never promised that we would not go through the valley of death. He never promised that. But he did promise that he would be with us through that valley. He did promise that in the midst of your problem, in the midst of your situation, no matter how great, how extreme it is, he promised that if you call upon him, if you believe in him, that he would be with you. That is his promise. And for that, I want to read a scripture, Psalm 23, verse 4. And the word of God says like this: "Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me." That is the promise of God, that he would be with us even if you are in that situation, that you're crossing the valley of the shadow of death. Many people have experienced those times, that moment. It is hard. It is not easy. But with God, with our Lord Jesus Christ, everything is possible. As the Apostle Paul, on verse 18, the last verse that we read before, he says these words: "Comfort one another with these words." And now, more than ever, the time that we're living, the things that we are seeing, we have to say the same words to encourage one another. And what are those words? I know we read a lot of words, a couple of verses, but I believe that the main message, and that's why I titled this message, the main words that we have to use to encourage our brethren, our family members, is that the King is coming soon. The King of Kings and Lord of Lords, he is coming soon. Those were words that the Apostle Paul said to his disciples, to the church, you know, to the believers, that, and not his disciples, the disciples of Jesus Christ. He said these words to encourage them when they saw there was no way out, when they were even facing death, because they were, you know, facing persecution. And the persecution that they were, you know, receiving at that moment, it wasn't just to reject you or just to, you know, make you stop preaching. No, it was actually to stop you, even, you know, with death. People were getting stoned to death. People were getting, you know, placed in death, you know, because of their belief. But now more than ever, we have to use those words. We have to proclaim him, declare him, and believe the King is coming soon. Hallelujah. That King is Jesus Christ. There is no other King, only one King, and his name is Jesus Christ. And that King overcame death. Now, he overcame death and he rose on the third day. Hallelujah. If there's someone and you can put your trust in, it's the one that fulfilled the scriptures. It is the only one that did what he said. He fulfilled whatever he promised. He fulfilled it. He said, "I will rise on the third day. Nobody takes my life. I give my life for many. I have the power to put it down and to take it back up. And that's exactly what he did. He took life and he took his life and he rose on the third day. And that's why I encourage you to trust him. But you might say, why? Why would I trust him? Why would I put my trust in him? I mentioned it before. Because whatever he promised, whatever he said that he was going to do, he did it. He said it. He proved it. He proved it how? That when he said that he was going to rise on the third day, that's what he did. So now we have to we have to believe in his promises. And when we say that we encourage you that the king is coming, it's because on his return, he gave promises to us that when he would come back for his church, there's great blessings for those that believe in him, for those that trust him. One of the things that he said, our King Jesus Christ promised to return for us and take us where he has prepared a place where we will dwell with him forever. He's promised to come back for us. So even though you might think that this is the only life that we have, or this is the only thing that we're going to go through suffering and that there is no hope, let me tell you, there is hope. Because the one that rose again on the third day, he said that he would come back for you and me. If we believe in him, if we trust him, he will come back for you and me. Look what it says on John, the Gospel of John chapter 14 from verse 1 to 3. Verse 1 says, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God? Believe also in me. Verse 2, in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And verse 3 says, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. That you may be also. Meaning that where he's going to be at, we're going to be with him. I don't know if those words do not encourage you. They do encourage me. Why? Because I don't plan to be in this earth forever. As it is, you know, all the hardships, all the situations that I have gone through, you know, all the problems and tribulations, I don't want to live a life in eternity like this. You know, I know there's so many good things in this world. I know that there is nice things that God created, but I'd rather be with my Lord Jesus Christ. I'd rather be with him. You know, these words give me a lot of hope that my King is coming, and one day I'm going to see him as he is. One day we're going to see him come back and see him exactly how he is. Right now, many people kind of paint pictures of Jesus, but nobody even knows how he really looked. The only ones that know how he looked were those that walk with him, those that are in his presence, angels, caravans. You know, they know how he is. And even though the Bible says that, you know, when some people receive revelations, they could not see him. His face was so bright. So it was a light, incomparable light that nobody could see. But the Bible says that when he comes back, we're going to be transformed. This body that is corrupted is going to come to become a body incorruptible. And we're going to see our Lord Jesus Christ. I don't know about you, but I'm waiting to see him, for him to hold me, for him to, you know, hug me. And be able to rest my head on his shoulder. Oh, it is so beautiful. And I encourage you, you know, to believe in him, to call upon him. He promised you. But you might say still, why? Why? Why would I put my trust in him? Or why would I be encouraged? Because let me tell you another promise that our King Jesus said. He promised to stop death, sorrow, pain, and wipe our tears away. He promised that. Look what it says on Revelation chapter 21, verse 4. It says, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There shall be no more death, nor sorrow, nor crying. There shall be no more pain, for the former things have passed away. Hallelujah. I mentioned it before. We live in a broken world. We live where nobody is exempt of suffering, of pain. We live in a broken world that we see evil, you know, rising up and, you know, destroying families, you know, hurting people, doing all kinds of things, you know, and I don't want to live in that situation. As it is, the Bible declares that as time passes by, as time goes forward, and man, time flies. Time goes so quick. But not only time goes so quick, but we see evil rising up more and more. We see how men are, you know, don't have no feelings. You know, they do so many horrible things. They are killing one another. You know, even now, you know, parents are killing their own children. And also children are killing their parents. There's so much things, so much crying, so many people dying from hunger, so many people dying from, you know, so many things. Even people, you know, being in bondage by other people, you know, they sell them for as instruments for prostitution. So many things. Even the babies don't even have a chance in these days. Why do I say the babies? Because unborn babies, you know, they're killing them in the mother's womb, abortion, you know, but God said, he promised, my Lord Jesus Christ, my King, he said that when he comes back, when he comes and picks his church, he said that there's not going to be no more death, no more sorrow, no more pain. Can you imagine that? With, you know, not having to worry about anything? Can you imagine that? That, you know, our King, when he comes back, is the end of suffering for us? Is the end of death for us? Can you imagine that? Our King is coming. And when we say our King is coming, is because these promises should be in our heart and in our mind. That when he comes back, whoa, I'm rejoicing. And I can't wait for him to come back. You may ask why he hasn't come yet. Why he's not here yet. It's been too long. You know, you want to go with him. I want to go with him. I want to be with him already. But then you might say, why? Why he's not here yet? Why he hasn't come back yet? He promised it. He promised that he would come back soon. It doesn't seem like it's soon for me. You know, many people have said that. Even people that have passed away, you know, in the past have mentioned that. And even the Bible declares that in the end times, the last days, people were going to even mock about that, saying, where is he going to come back? But let me tell you, our King Jesus Christ is a loving God and a merciful God. Why he hasn't come back is because he loves his creation. He loves humanity so much. That's why he came and died on the cross. That's why he gave himself for you and me, because he loves us. You know, he loves us so much that even though we were sinners, Christ still died for us. Even though we didn't deserve it, God loves us so much that he gave his life for us. Look what it says on 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 9. And I'm going to read from the Amplified Version. The Bible says, the Word of God says, the Lord does not delay as though he were unable to act. It's not that he's not unable to act. He is almighty. He can do it anytime. And it is not slow about his promise, as some count slowness, but is extraordinarily patient toward you, not wishing for any to perish, but for all to come to repentance. The reason he has to come back is because he's waiting on you. He's waiting on me. He's waiting on your neighbor. He's waiting on your family member or your friend. He's waiting on that nation, that place where the gospel is, needs to reach that person. Our God is a merciful God, a loving God. Our God knows every person in the world. And he knows if you have accepted him, have repented. He knows if you have surrendered to him. Like the word, like his word says, he doesn't want anybody to perish. He doesn't want anybody to stay behind. He did not came to condemn the world. Many people say that why, if he's a loving God, why he wants to condemn people or send them to hell. No, my God does not want to send you to hell. My God does not want to send people to hell. And that's the reason he hasn't come yet, because he's waiting on you for you to make that decision, for someone that is watching, some family member, or even you yourself. You already got baptized in the name of Jesus Christ, but you went astray. You have left the ways of the Lord. You have gone to serve other gods and worship other things. God is waiting for you to come back. He is the loving Father, just like the prodigal son, the story of the prodigal son. It is not the father that left. It is not the father that gave the inheritance to his son and say, here, I give it to you so you can leave. No, the son was the one that made a decision to leave. But the father, it's always there, stretching his arms so you can come back. So with all that, and you know that, you know, he's merciful and that's why he hasn't come back. Maybe you ask, then when is he coming? When is he coming? Let me tell you, nobody knows. Nobody knows when he's coming. Nobody knows the time or the hour. But our King Jesus said this. Our King Jesus Christ, he said before he comes back, he said he wants you to be ready. He wants you to be ready and not to fall into a spiritual sleepiness. He wants you to be awake. You see, he wants you to be doing what he has called you to do. He wants you to keep going forward because you don't know the time or the hour. You don't know when he's coming. He mentioned it many times, but you have to be ready. I often tell my children, and I tell people these words. You have to live like if Christ is coming today. But also you have to live like if Christ is going to come in 1,000 years, meaning that you have to live in holiness. You have to be prepared. You have to be ready. But at the same time, you have to be doing what God has called you to do. You have to do what he has called you to do, and for this world, for his kingdom. The word of God in Matthew chapter 24, verse 42 through 44, it says, therefore, stay awake, for you do not know what day your Lord is coming. Verse 43, but know this, that if the master of the house had known in what part of the night the thief was coming, he would have stayed awake and would not have let his house be broken into. Verse 44, it says, therefore, you also must be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour you do not expect. We don't know when he's coming. We don't know when he's coming, but you gotta be ready. We have to be mature. It is time that we have to be mature, and it is time to encourage ourselves with the word of God. It is time for us to not fall into sleep. The other thing is, our King Jesus Christ also spoke about certain things in the time of his coming. You might say, well, when is he coming? Well, we don't know the time. We don't know when, you know, when it's going to happen, but he said to be ready. But he did give us a sign when it was soon to come, soon his coming. And if you go on Luke chapter 17, verse 26 through 27, this is the first sign that he gave on his soon return. And it says, just as it was in the days of Noah, so also will it be in the days of the Son of Man. People were eating, drinking, marrying, and being given into marriage. In the day of Noah entered the ark, then the flood came and destroyed them all. That is the first sign before the coming of the Lord. And it is so clear, hallelujah, because that sign speaks about one thing. In the days of Noah, the sin was so great. It was so great that it came before the Lord. But one of the things that, you know, gets me at my attention, and you can read it in Genesis chapter 6, so you might get a better understanding, you know, is that in those days of Noah, the unbelief was so great. The unbelief. Noah preached for almost 100 years. You know, he almost preached for almost 100 years. And, you know, nobody believed them. Nobody believed that there was going to be a flood. They mocked him. Today we preach about Jesus Christ, and some people say, I believe, but they don't really believe. Because when you believe, you will turn. And that is happening. There's another sign that Jesus spoke before his soon return. And that is in the same book, the chapter of Luke, verse 17, verse 28 and 30. It says, it was the same in the days of Lot. People were eating and drinking, buying and selling, planting and building. But the day Lot left Sodom, fire and sulfur rained down from heaven and destroyed them all. Verse 30, it says, it will be just like this on the day of the Son of Man is revealed. That's the other sign that God said, you know, that our Lord Jesus Christ gave us, that when the days are like Sodom and Gomorrah, his coming is soon. You might say, well, what is that sign? That sign is so clearly. And that day, you know, in those days, one of the things that stood up so strongly was homosexuality. You know, think the men given into men and women into women, you know, and you might say, well, why is he addressing that point? Or why is he only speaking about, no, I'm not against anybody because God loves us. But he gave this sign as one of the greatest signs saying that the Lord is coming. Because when that happens, you know, the breaking down of morality, it's at its peak. And we are at that moment. So we're living those last days when the King is coming soon. King is the God Almighty. There's nothing impossible for him. There's nothing. There's one thing that God cannot do, though, is he cannot lie. So if he said he's coming, he is coming. He's coming soon for you, for me, for everyone that believes in him. But the question is, are you ready? See, the gift of life is the most precious thing that God gave us. And that is the same gift that he wants to offer you. Not just to live in this world a good life, but he wants to offer it to you so you can have eternal life. If you haven't accepted Jesus Christ, if you haven't surrendered to Jesus Christ, he said, hallelujah. Jesus said in John chapter 3, verse 5, verily, I say unto you, that if you're not born of water and the Spirit, you will not enter into the kingdom of God. You need to be born again. You need to be born again. Also in Acts chapter 2, verse 38 and 39, it said, the word of God says, Peter replied, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. This is the promise for you and your children and for all who are afar, for all whom the Lord God will call. That is the promise. If you already are walking with him and you have gone astray, Turn back, because the King is coming. And for those that are being faithful, the King is coming. Rejoice. I'm going to just ask you to bow your head and let us pray. Thank you, Father, for this word that you have given us. I thank you for your goodness and your blessings, Father. I ask that this word will penetrate someone's heart, Father, and that you will, Father, make it grow so that they can turn to you and that we can be ready for your coming. I rejoice and I wait, Father, that you're going to come back. I cannot wait for that day because I know it is going to be beautiful and amazing to be with you forever. In the name of Jesus Christ, I thank you, Father. Amen. Thank you.
just a glimpse of your glory. Just a minute, nothing more. I give my all, it wouldn't matter. The price I have to pay, or how long I have to wait.
Yes, God.
Just a moment in your presence. Just an instant of your love.
That's all I'm asking for, God.
Just a glimpse of your glory. Just a minute, nothing more.
And here's what I'll give.
I'll give my all. It wouldn't matter the price I have to pay, or how long I'll have to wait. Lord, I hunger for you, for your presence, for your fragrance, for your power. Hunger that hurts, hunger that weakens in desperation. Just a glimpse of your glory.
I don't want you forever, God, just for a minute.
Just a minute, nothing more. I give my all, it wouldn't matter the price I had to pay, or how long I had to wait.
Because, God, I'm hungry for you.
For you, for your presence, for your fragrance, for your power. Hunger that hurts, hunger that weakens in desperation. For you, Lord, I hunger for.
Thank you for being with us. We hope that the worship and message was a blessing for your life. Don't forget to join us next week at the same time. God bless you, and please stay tuned for some announcements. Amen. We'll be right back.